evening, everyone. Let's all stand together, redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I love this song. Let's sing it. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed. His child and forever.
Good evening, good singing, what a good song. Let's start out together with a word of prayer. Father, we are thankful that we can know, have knowledge, that we have eternal life through the redemption that's found in Christ and faith in Him. We pray that you'd help us to reflect on that as we not only live our lives day to day, but as we think about the Christmas season and as we celebrate our Savior being born and what that means for us and for the world, to help us to be light of that, share the light of that to the people around us as well. We just pray that you be with our services tonight and the teens and that meeting that they will be having as they look ahead at the new year. We just pray that you bless our time together. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Who is on the Lord's side? King's own army. Savior, we are thine. Good singing, away in a manger, no crib for a bed.
Look ahead at the rest of the week to come. We have Whispering Christmas, which will be taking place tomorrow night. We're going to be giving away bags with tracks and some candy canes to the cars who drive through. And so if you volunteered to help with that, there are some maps that help you to know how to get in and to the right place. And if you have any questions about that, I can try to help you coordinate that. But that'll be tomorrow night. From about 6:30 to 8:30, and so looking forward to that. If you want to drive through and be a part of that, you can just drive through, and if you're volunteering to help, we'll enjoy that time together tomorrow, and there are maps on the back table to grab. The Young Adult Christmas Party is at 7 p.m. at the McIntyre's house. That's this Friday, and then, of course, our Christmas program will begin. It'll take place on Saturday at 6 p.m. as well as on Sunday night at 6 p.m. There are some other invitations you can hand out, and those are available to give to others to invite them. And certainly looking forward to that, praying that that goes well and is a blessing. Let's go ahead and have the men come, if you would, for the offering. If you would still like to give for the building fund offering that we took on Sunday, you can do that. Just take an offering envelope and put building fund on there if you would. That would help. Or you can do that online as well. But if you would just, you can go ahead and still give to that and be a part of that offering, but just designate it, if you would, on an offering envelope. That would be helpful. Brother Bill, if you'd come, lead us in prayer for our offering.
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this glorious day that you've given to us and for allowing us to come into your house tonight to hear your word preached. We ask that you be with the super church next door and those kids over there and open their ears and their hearts to the words that will be preached there. And be with the teens next door as they're having their meeting to try and figure out what they were going to be looking forward to doing next year. And we ask that you be with the military and watch over them and keep them safe and missionaries around the world. And we ask you, Lord, as we collect this offering, that you bless both the gift and the giver alike. Amen.
Amen. I'd like to invite you to take your Bibles, if you would, and we'll be looking together at Jonah chapter number 4. the last of the chapters that tell us this account of Jonah's life and ministry to the city of Nineveh. And we'll read verses 1 through 5, Lord willing. We'll wrap up some loose ends next week and complete this study of this, and then looking forward to a candlelight service and some other things as we move into the Christmas season. Jonah chapter number 4 in verse number 1. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was very angry. And he prayed unto the Lord and said, I pray thee, O Lord, was not this my saying when I was yet in my country? Therefore I fled before unto Tarshish, for I knew that thou art a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness, and repentest thee of the evil. Therefore now, O Lord, take, I beseech thee, my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. Then said the Lord, doest thou well to be angry? So Jonah went out of the city and sat on the east side of the city, and there made him a booth and sat under it in the shadow till he might see what would become of the city. Think about the last time you were displeased, exceedingly displeased. You were upset, hot under the collar. I don't know if that would have been a few minutes ago or a year ago or perhaps in another lifetime, but I think many of us have experienced powerful emotions. Even if you're pretty laid back, most of us have been there. There was a mother and her little boy driving through the town, and pretty quiet trip, and the little boy piped up, Mom, why do the idiots only come out when Daddy drives? Benjamin Franklin was to have said, anger is never without a reason, but seldom with a good one. We all experience emotion, and anger is certainly one I think we all identify with as human beings, and we know that not all anger is bad. Expressions of frustration, or perhaps even we know that there are things wrong with the world, and we may have a natural reaction to that, but we're going to call this lesson, if you will, the pouting prophet, or we see a pouting prophet that really seems to be what he's doing in response to what's going on, and we'll talk about that in just a moment, but calling him a pouting prophet, I don't think it's good to just skip over lightly what's going on in his life. These are very real emotions that he's experiencing, and they've been going on for a while in his life. There's some deep lessons he's facing. There's some real feeling that's going on. He is not just upset in a moment. In fact, the context for his upsetness is very surprising. Why is he upset? What's going on? And why is this such a real visceral thing for him? These are some of the questions that we ask as we read about this. He is really distraught. There is something wrong with Jonah's heart. In Proverbs, we're told, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. We're supposed to pay attention to our hearts. We're supposed to think about how we're viewing the world and how we think about God. A.W. Tozer said, what a man thinks about when he thinks about God is the most important thing about him. And knowing and just being aware of our own sensibilities to these things. Keep thy heart with all diligence. What we love, our affections, what we are afraid of, what we are longing for. These are things to pay attention to. And the lessons he's learning run very deep in his life. He's angry, and the circumstances surrounding his anger are really remarkable. The last time we looked in the end of chapter number 3, and we left Jonah in Nineveh. He had finally arrived there. He had come not by letter or by voicemail or by telegram, but he physically came and he preached the message. It was very simple. It was very short. It doesn't seem to be very elaborate. He had preached that city, traveled one day into the city, and he preached the message. And the city responds powerfully. I mean, the ideal response to a revival. They go into fasting, and they put on sackcloth, and they acknowledge their sin, and they are told by the king and the nobles all the way down to the littlest animals to pray and cry out to the Lord, acknowledging their sin, turning from their evil way, and asking that perhaps God might be merciful and show them mercy. And we see that God does respond to that in chapter number 10, 3, verse 10, that after God saw this response, that they turned from their evil way, God repented of the evil. Now, God had told Jonah to preach in 40 days, Nineveh will be overthrown, destroyed, and now God responds, and he shows grace, and that which he had planned to do, he did it not. This is really amazing. Not only is God going to preserve all the lives of these hundreds of thousands of people, but they have responded in a spiritual way, and they really seem to have real evidence of this going on. Now, there's more to the history of Nineveh that we can read about in other books, but as we see it here, there's something remarkable going on. You would think that Jonah would be quite excited, thrilled even. Instead, he's angry. There's three observations just from these five verses that I think we can structure our thoughts around tonight, and they are like this. Number one, Jonah's anger. Secondly, Jonah's theology. And then thirdly, Jonah's loneliness. Let's look at Jonah's anger in verse number four. It says that, verse number one, it displeased Jonah. The response, not only of the Ninevites, but God's grace to the Ninevites, God's mercy that he showed in not destroying them. Jonah evidently wanted them destroyed to such an extent that when they weren't, he was angry. Not just angry, but very, very angry. Have you ever felt powerful emotions and you didn't know exactly why? Perhaps good emotions, perhaps sad emotions, perhaps angry emotions. Perhaps you hear a little bit of music, or you visit an old house or workplace, or you see a picture and you have these emotions that come into your life. Well, I don't know if there was any sort of confusion in his heart, but here Jonah, he's a prophet. He's a God-fearing man. But in this story, he's the one who is at odds with God. He asks for his own life to be taken. There's something wrong with Jonah. There really is something. You wouldn't want to invite him over to your Christmas party. Not in this stage. He's the one who's at odds with God. He's the one who God is doing something and he is standing in opposition. It's the sailors who repent. It's the Ninevites who repent. And it's Jonah who God is working in his life. It reminds us of another phenomenon in the Bible, doesn't it? In the New Testament, there were people who should have known better, people who you would have thought would have been the most eager to walk with Christ and follow Christ, and they were the ones who found themselves at odds with Christ. That would be the Pharisees, right? We read about the Pharisees, for example, in Luke chapter 6 and verse 10, where Jesus heals a man on the Sabbath day, and there was a lot of sort of tradition around the Sabbath day. There was obviously God's law about respecting it, and it was to be a day of rest, but there were just all sorts of extra rules that they had created around observing it, and actually became more of a burden than a blessing. But the Pharisees had a bone to pick with Jesus, and Jesus, a man with a withered hand, comes in, and Jesus ends up healing this man. A great thing, God showing compassion, of course, Jesus healing him, and the man who had a crippled hand that was healed. But in chapter 6, verse 10, in looking round about them all, Jesus said unto the man, stretch forth thy hand, and he did so, and his hand was restored whole as the other. And notice the response. And they were filled with madness and communed one with another what they might do with Jesus. They were upset. They were filled with anger. Of course, the Jews, the Pharisees will be the ones who, many of them who instigate leading to the crucifixion. We have another story that ties so closely to this. I think it's worth our time to read again. We looked at it earlier, but a lot of these lessons in Jonah repeat. We have chapter 1 and chapter 2, and then we have these kind of repeat. These lessons kind of go together, and we go a little deeper. And so I'd encourage you also to join me in Luke chapter 15 and verse 25, and we'll go back to the story of the prodigal son, or perhaps we could just say it's the story of the two brothers, the parable of the two brothers, an older brother and a younger brother. And as we think about this angry response or this confusing emotion in response to what should be good, we find ourselves seeing it here in this story, Luke 15, 25. So we have the older brother and the younger brother. We have the younger brother who goes and wastes his substance, his inheritance, and he repents and he comes back and everyone's excited. This son who was gone and never to be seen again, has now returned, and he's repentant. And so verse 25, now his elder son was in the field, and as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing, and he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. What's the party? I didn't know we were planning anything today. And the servant says, thy brother is come, and thy father hath killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound. Your brother, your younger brother, he's back. You haven't seen him in all these months, all these years. We thought he was dead. He's back. In verse 28, he was angry, and he would not go in. He's sitting out in the field sulking. So his father comes out. He leaves the party. He leaves everything that's going on, and he finds the son, and he says, son. In verse 29, and he answered, said to his father, lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgressed I at any time thy commandment, and yet thou never gavest me a kid that I might make merry with my friends. But the instant, right, as soon as this thy son come, which hath devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. And the father said unto him, son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. It was meet that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead and is alive again and was lost and is found. And there's a lesson there in the parable that Jesus is telling that is a lot more than just the prodigal returning. That's a part of it. But the other lesson is for the Pharisees who are listening. As they feel themselves to be in a respected place, and now God is showing mercy to the sinners and the publicans and visiting with them, and And God is bringing them into the family, calling them to follow them. They're being converted. And there's just something going on there. There's a jealousy. I don't know anything about jealousy. I only had seven brothers, and we got along perfectly. And I can't identify in the least. The reality, Jonah is angry for sad, but I think common reasons. Perhaps he felt unjustly treated. This wasn't fair. God was Israel's God, and Assyria was the enemy of Israel, and under no circumstances should they have any sort of grace or success, or God should show his attention or love to them. Maybe Jonah is tired. He's made this journey, and he's been through a lot, and there might be some physical things going on as well, and he's resentful. There's something about the history there, right? Something from years ago. There's a history there between the Assyrian people and the Israelites. And he's resentful. And it's very deep, and it's something that's going on in his life. Now, these emotions are something we see visibly, especially in emotionally immature people, also known as children. Have you ever gotten jealous of someone else's good fortune? Ever felt that emotion, any of you? I have. You have a friend or a brother or someone like that, and they win a prize, and you are competing, and they win the Monopoly game after 3 hours or whatever the case is, and those emotions, I've experienced them. I just can only assume that maybe many of you have as well. We know that this has been a problem, this festering of this, this allowing of this to go on in the heart has been a problem in human history. We know that two brothers, the first two brothers, Abel and Cain, offer sacrifices to the Lord, and God receives Abel's sacrifice, and there's something that goes on in Cain's heart in response to that, where the end result is Cain will commit the first murder. We know that there was another family, Joseph, and he had a bunch of brothers, and his dad, for better or for worse, shows extra favor to Joseph, and as a result of that resentment, as a result of those emotions, as a result of whatever's going on in the lives of their brothers, they change the course of their whole family, and they sell Joseph into slavery, and God uses it, but what a difficult circumstance. How powerful these emotions can be in our hearts. Imagine with me for a moment, what would the world be like without selfishness? What if we didn't cure cancer? We didn't solve all the world's problems, but we could just fix that part of it, right? Wouldn't it change the course of everything? Well, Jonah has his own agenda, his own ideas, his own emotions, and he's letting them run wild in his own life. Jonah is angry. And God asks him a question which we must ask ourselves when we experience these emotions, and in particular when we experience these emotions over time. We need to ask ourselves the question God asks Jonah in verse number 4. Then said the Lord, "Doest thou well to be angry?" I know you're experiencing this emotion, and you have your reasons potentially in your own mind, in your own head. And maybe there is some history there between the Assyrians and maybe this is going on, but Jonah, if you're going to reflect for a moment, is it really well for you to be angry? And you're going to notice that Jonah doesn't answer that question. And as we conclude our lesson, the book of Jonah, we'll cover the last part of this that God spends time with him, working with him about. But someone said this: anger plus time equals bitterness. Anger plus time equals bitterness. And bitterness is caustic to any vessel that holds it. And we're seeing something going on in Jonah's life in response to this. Perhaps it's a national prejudice. I think we can safely assume there is some of that there. Israel and Assyrians and all the history that went on. And that we can read about it in the Bible, of course, and even in human history, all of these different emotions that happened over time. My grandmother wrote her story about growing up in Danzig, an independent state, and then the war, World War II, and Russia coming in, and then Germany coming back, and then the Marshall Plan, and millions of people being displaced. And she tells a story of being on a train and losing all their belongings, and happened to millions of people. And at the end of her story, she says, it wasn't until lately, she's writing her story in the 70s, when she's in her 70s, and she says, it wasn't until lately that I've done some other reading on this subject, and I realized more of what was going on, why so many people had to be displaced and moved. But just by reading her story, I get a sense of how difficult it can be, it must have been, for people with these national histories and families involved, and a lot of emotions probably came along with it. But what Jonah had, was a heart condition, and he needed therapy. You could say gospel therapy. It's Christmas time this time of year. It's a time we reflect on the birth of a Savior. It's a time of peace and goodwill toward men. It's a time when John 3:16 comes alive, when we read, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son." If there's anger in our life, or resentment, or jealousy, or bitterness in our heart, it's time to acknowledge it. It's not a light thing to forgive. If there wasn't something to forgive, then we wouldn't actually have forgiveness. And so it's okay to acknowledge what the wrong was, or what our heart is, or acknowledge the emotions that we're experiencing. That's okay. In fact, I think that's even important to perhaps know it and feel it and acknowledge it. But there comes a time then we give it to God, knowing that he alone is wise enough to handle it. He alone is able to take care of these things and to be the judge and the jury and to take care of reputation and time and in eternity. We know that Jesus will say on the cross in response to what he was going through, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Forgiveness can cost a lot. There can be a lot that goes along with it, but it's so important to follow the steps of Jesus and give that to the Lord and allow him to have what will just destroy us and destroy the people around us. We see Jonah's anger, but we also see Jonah's theology in verse number 2. He prays unto the Lord. This is the second time Jonah prays. Of course, the word of the Lord had come to Jonah, and he ran away, and he gets swallowed up by the fish or the whale, and he's in there, and eventually he prays, and now he's praying again, and he says to the Lord, "I knew this would happen. Was not this my saying when I was yet in my country? I could have predicted it. In fact, I was back in Joppa, or before I even went to Joppa, and the word of the Lord came, and I was supposed to go to Nineveh and preach to them, and there was just something. I knew about you, God. I knew that you had a plan for them, and I just didn't like that idea. And so I left and fled to Tarshish. Why? I knew you were a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness," I like that one especially, "and repentest thee of the evil." God, I didn't want to come here in the first place. I knew this was going to happen. It's not right. It's not fair. But he had good theology. In Psalms 116 and verse 5, it says, "Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Yea, our God is merciful." When Jesus comes, we are identified, introduced to Jesus as someone full of grace and truth. His grace does not take away from truth. His grace and mercy doesn't take away from justice. They are in agreement, and that's why the cross is such a critical component when we think about redemption and forgiveness and salvation and mercy. Without the cross, it doesn't work. We need that. That's an important part of what we understand in our lives and how we forgive and how we experience forgiveness. But he comes, he's merciful. He's gracious. He gives and provides. And it's so important, isn't it, for us to be thankful as we did at Thanksgiving time. Someone said, what if the only things we had tomorrow were the things we were thankful for today? We take a lot more time to be thankful for the color yellow, Brother Bob, or the sunsets, or I don't know, the fire we have, the warmth. But taking time to just acknowledge the graciousness of God, the goodness of God, undeserved, his mercy. In Micah chapter 6 and verse 8, we have the prophet Micah. He's preaching and he reminds us that we're expected, we're challenged as a what is required of thee, but to do justly and to love mercy and walk humbly with thy God. Jonah didn't have that one down yet. Love mercy. The ability to give mercy. To rest in the mercy of God. He was slow to anger. In James chapter 1:19, we're reminded, wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath, for the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. As we grow up spiritually, we're supposed to not be so quick to react in our own emotion, in our own speaking, and we have all the answers, but to pause a moment, to reflect. The wrath of man worketh not at the righteousness of God. He's of great kindness. In Psalms 103, verse 13, like as a father pitieth his children. There's a special empathy there for a father to his children. So the Lord pitieth them that fear him. He knoweth our frame, and he remembereth that we are dust. He's kind. He knows who you are. He knows your capabilities. He knows your limitations. He knows your experiences. He knows all your genetic code. He knows you. He knows me. He knows us, and he's kind. He remembers that we are dust, and he meets us where we need to be met, and he calls us and invites us to a relationship with him. And he repenteth thee of the evil. In Joel chapter 2, in verse 12 and 13, I believe what Joel is doing is he's sort of quoting from Jonah. He says, therefore also now saith the Lord, turn ye even to me with all your heart and with fasting and with weeping and with mourning. And now he's preaching to Israel, but he says, and rend your heart, not your garments, and turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness, and repenteth him of the evil. God wants to preserve you. God wants to lead you. God wants to provide for you. It's amazing what God has planned for you if you'll trust him and follow him and follow the path he provides and not just go our own way because of the emotions or our own thoughts. In Jeremiah chapter 29 and verse 10 and 11, we know that Jeremiah is speaking to the Israelites who have been taken captive in Babylon, and they're going to be there 70 years. 70 years, they're going to be away from home, and it's going to be a rough thing. But he reminds them in verse 10, for thus saith the Lord, that after 70 years be accomplished at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good word toward you in causing you to return to this place. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. There's a plan. There's a plan. It might be a difficult season. There might be some confusion. There might be some challenges, but there's an expected end. There's something to come, and we can trust in God's plan. In Revelation 21:4, about the very end of the Bible as you read it, it says that God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. What an amazing thing to reflect on, that this life is just such a short piece of what real life, real reality is. And in that context, so many of the things we may get upset about or be resentful for just won't mean anything in light of eternity. And it's something for us to bear in mind in this life. Well, Jonah was angry, and Jonah knew some things about the Lord, although he didn't agree with God in that moment. And lastly, we see Jonah's loneliness. And just the thought there comes from verses 3, 4, and 5. And so in verse 3, he really expresses, I guess he's throwing a pity party of some nature here. Verse 3, he says, "Therefore, O Lord, take, I beseech thee, I beg you, just take my life from me. For it is better for me to die than to live." Then said the Lord, "Doest thou well to be angry?" And so Jonah goes out of the city, and he sat on the east side of the city, and there made him a booth, and sat under it in the shadow till he might see what would become of the city. This is an interesting picture. So Jonah's 500 miles from home. He's there by himself in the city. They've repented, though. They heard Jonah's message, and they have responded in an incredible way. There's so much for Jonah to do. There's so many people for him to talk to. There's so much for him in Nineveh, and he gets out of there as fast as he can. And he leaves, and he's on the east side of it, and he's away from the city, and he sets up a little spot for himself, and he's there just to see. I don't know what's going on his head. It's probably not great, but there he is. He's by himself. He'd rather die than think about the Ninevites. He'd rather die than to live with the knowledge that God has shown mercy to them. He knew the character of God, but in that time in his life, he didn't like it. He didn't like God showing mercy to them. There is something of despair going on in his life. You read that when he talks about the Lord taking his life and feeling like there wasn't, meaning to life. It's hard. It's hard to get in Jonah's head here. But we know that someone else did something similar. In a book of 1 Kings chapter 19, we have another prophet. We have a prophet who saw something incredible happen. God revealed himself on Mount Carmel and sent down fire from heaven and consumed the sacrifice, and Elijah was vindicated and the prophets of Baal were killed, and everything was wonderful, a mountaintop experience. But in verse 1 of chapter 19, Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and withal how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah saying, "So let the gods do to me, and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time." So I am planning on making sure you're as dead as the other prophets are by tomorrow at 7:38. And so in verse number 3, "And when he saw that, he arose and went for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there. And he went himself, went a day's journey into the wilderness, and came and sat down under a juniper tree. And he requested for himself that he might die, and said, 'It is enough. Now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am not better than my father's.'" So there he is. He's had a long day, a long few days. It's an amazing victory, but he's tired. And boy, that's a tough time. He's feeling lonely. He runs, he's by himself now, and it's kind of a tough time. Now, I've had this experience once in my life where I could have prayed a prayer like that. I had the stomach flu. Any of you had those times? Looking back at it now, I'm glad I didn't die, but I was toying. I didn't appreciate life in the moment. Time gives perspective to that. But here he is. He's had this incredible experience, but he's in this emotional state, spiritual state. What does God do? Well, verse 5 is interesting. "He lays and he sleeps under a juniper tree, and the angel touches him and says, 'Arise and eat.'" He needed to sleep. He needed to eat. These are physical things, and then God sends an angel to help him with that. "He looked, and behold, there was a cake baking on the coals and a cruse of water at his head, and he did eat and drink and laid him down again. And the angel of the Lord came again the second time and touched him and said, 'Arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee.' And he arose and did eat and drink and went in the strength of that meat 40 days and 40 nights unto Horeb, the Mount of God. There's a lot more we can talk about and learn about what's going on in Elijah's life, but isn't it interesting how there's a similarity between Jonah and Elijah? Jonah has a whole different thing going on in his life, but Elijah was tired and he was in a tough spot and he was feeling lonely. Selfishness will make you lonely. And sometimes it'll drive us away from the people we need to be around. Things can come up in our life, and instead of having the conversations we need to have, we'll run from them. Or perhaps we'll just find ourselves in a world that we build up around ourselves. I used to enjoy going to a church growing up, not too far away, would do the Christmas Carol, and they'd have Ebenezer Scrooge, and they'd have the Ghost of Christmas Past, and they'd have all of that stuff, and they did a good job. I always enjoyed going and seeing the guy in the baptistry. It was a Baptist church, and they had, I knew how it all worked out, but it was neat to see them do the story. But of course, Ebenezer Scrooge, as he's trying to learn about the place where he's found himself rich, but without any true meaningful relationships or meaning in his life. The other one story famous around this time, of course, is, can't think of it. It's a Wonderful Life, Mr. Potter, right? And Mr. Potter, great guy. Not really, but here he is living his life and rich but lonely. And what's the lesson? What are these stories trying to teach us? What's the lesson in these things? A biblical example, we learn about Saul in the Bible, a guy who had a lot of talent and a lot of abilities, and he's the first king of Israel, but we see his life begin to spiral out of control as he rebels against the Lord and disobeys him, and then he begins to get paranoid and resentful of David. David is getting some attention, and instead of leading the kingdom to prosperity and to worship and these things, he begins to just attack and lash out. And of course, he dies and his son dies to basically the suicide at the loss of a battle. Selfishness will make you lonely. The lacking of a capacity to trust God and to show forgiveness. What we can't say is that it's easy. We can't say that for Jonah, it wouldn't cost him anything. Forgiveness is costly, but it's worth it. And we have the capacity to forgive if we know Christ, because we've been forgiven. Someone said something about love this way. He said, to love at all is to be vulnerable. Love anything and your heart will be wrung and possibly broken. If you want to make sure of keeping it intact, you must give it to no one, not even an animal. Wrap it carefully round with hobbies and little luxuries. Avoid all entanglements. Lock it up safe in the casket or coffin of your selfishness. But in that casket, safe, dark, motionless, airless, it will change. It will not be broken. It will become unbreakable, impenetrable, irredeemable. To love is to be vulnerable. I'm thankful that God did send his son to come to earth and lay down his life for us. Peter reminds us in 1 Peter 2:21, he says, for here, even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should walk in his steps, who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth, who, when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. What a wonderful testimony from a man like Peter, who had some spiritual, but maybe you could say emotionally immature tendencies as he lived his life following Jesus. But here, as an older man, as a Christian, he says, let's follow in Jesus' steps, acknowledging some of the real challenges that might be going on in our lives, certainly in Jonah's life, as he has to look back. There's national things going on, political things going on. There's many years of history here. And for whatever reason, Jonah, as he reflects on this, isn't having the attitude, the response we would expect him to have. But it's time for Jonah to consider this question. Doest thou well to be angry? Let's ask ourselves that question when we experience these emotions in our life, and let's look to Christ for his help and example. Father, we are thankful for the accounts in the Bible that are for our learning, our individual experiences in life often are very different. But Lord, we can learn from the different characters in the Bible, and certainly as Jonah exposes himself in this book to our critical examination, Lord, help us to learn from his life. I do pray, Lord, that you'd help us to be missionaries and have a missionary heart and to give the gospel, but Lord, that the gospel would affect our heart first as we live out the Christian life. Lord, that we would take the meaning of love and the meaning of forgiveness to heart first, that you love us and have given us what you've given us in Christ, but to have the wisdom and the courage and insight to reflect on our own lives and know, Lord, how to forgive. I pray, Lord, for our nation, for our world, as we approach the Christmas season, I pray for our hearts that they'd be tender and open to what you might be teaching us, that as so much information is going on in the world and we watch the news and there's turmoil, it seems that in the midst of it all, Lord, the gospel would be made clear. Your desire for us to turn from our sin and to trust in the provision of your Savior. We just pray that you'd help us to have that true in our own hearts and to give that to others. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Keep your heads bowed and eyes closed if you would. As the piano plays, I'd just like to invite you to spend a moment in prayer with the Lord in your own heart. I don't know what emotions you experience. I hope you have a deep love for the Lord and you know the love of your family, maybe your Christian family. But if there are other things you're dealing with, I just ask you to give them to the Lord. Ask for his help to view those things. Perhaps there are things like Jonah, and God just asked that question, doest thou well to be angry? And then just take joy in that God, the character of God, that he does love to show mercy and grace. He does love to show kindness to anyone who will look to him. He'll take you, receive you, wash you, look to him.